on celebrating the work of Dunoon Grammar School. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak button, and I call on Donald Cameron to open the debate. Mr Cameron.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to be able to bring forward this debate this evening and to highlight the fantastic work of Dunoon Grammar School to the Scottish Parliament. I want to thank Gillian Hunt, who is in the gallery, for all her encouragement and enthusiasm in terms of lodging the motion which is behind this debate this evening. I also want to thank David Mitchell, who is the head teacher of Dunoon Grammar School, who I will mention a few times during my speech. He is also in the gallery, always making his way there. I think the early decision time might have caught him on the hop. But he and a group of young people from Dunoon Grammar, who have been in the Parliament this afternoon, are also in the gallery. Deputy Presiding Officer, Dunoon Grammar achieved so much under the leadership of David Mitchell and his staff. And in my time as an MSP, I have submitted 8 motions recognising various successes, such as the sheer number of achievements of the staff and pupils of that school over the years. This is a school at the heart of its community. It's also a school that is very open and welcoming to politicians. In fact, my first experience of the school was at a hustings in the 2016 election campaign there, and I've spoken alongside Mike Russell, the former Cabinet Secretary and MSP for Argyll and Bute, at a class for modern studies pupils in that school. Such are the successes of Dunoon Grammar that it has been, I think, the first ever Scottish school to be named in the European Entrepreneurial School of the Year Awards in 2019 for its work in promoting entrepreneurial initiatives. Teams of pupils have won awards at the Apps for Good UK Showcase over the years, with 2 teams from Dunoon Grammar winning prizes in 2023. Dunoon Grammar is a regular entrant at the Scottish Education Awards, with David Mitchell nominated last year, and the school winning the Gaelic Education Award in 2022. But perhaps most notably, Dunoon Grammar was named the world's best school for community collaboration in 2022 by the global teaching platform T4. Education. None of these achievements have been accidental, and all have happened because of that school's relentless focus on being an institution that actively collaborates with the community that it serves. And there have been a number of these collaborations. Yes, of course.
Jenny Minto.
I thank Donald Cameron for his intervention. And
could we please have Ms. Minto's?
Oh, I think I'd know that by now.
Thank you. Thank you. Please go ahead.
Great. Sorry. My apologies. Thank Donald Cameron for that intervention and absolutely recognise the glowing way that he is speaking with regards to Dunoon Grammar School. Many of my visits have had the same positivity. I wonder if Donald Cameron would like to agree with me that and express our thanks to the following teachers, specifically Paul Gallina, for the work that he did with regards to entering the school, but also Scott McKinnon and Pam McNaughton on developing the future workforce, the young work.
Donald Cameron.
I'm of course grateful to Jenny Minto for mentioning those two teachers, and it's really important actually that we get on record the names of not just the head teacher but other leaders in the school who have driven it forward. I was discussing the collaboration, community collaboration. I just focus on one project. There is an empty toy library in Dunoon, which was owned by Argyll and Bute Council, and that has been passed to the school with plans for it to become a new community facility, and pupils will play an integral role in the success of the project. And there are plans for it, for example, to host adult learning classes delivered by young people, a garden run by the school's learning centre, and a community cafe where young people can learn skills for future life. And not only is that a positive project that is being pursued for the benefit of pupils, but it is giving back to the local community and bringing an empty space into good use. Now, Gillian Hunt. Yes, of course.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
I thank the member for taking this intervention, and would the member agree with me that in focusing on the SCQF framework and the need to offer alternative courses for young people, exactly the sort of description he's just described around the community focus and the award-winning school that it is. Would they agree with me that that framework is a useful framework for young people who need all sorts of support to achieve the best they possibly can in school?
I do agree that the breadth of subjects that is available is intrinsically important to young people. The member will know that the challenges that we all face in subject choice at schools in Scotland. But I think the point I'd like to make is that this is a project, for instance, that gives back to the local community. There was a report done by Gillian Hunt in 2023 entitled High Dunoon, which explains that work and those projects and why it's been such a success. And it's been taken up by the respective think tank Reform Scotland, which was a report that featured in a number of national newspapers last year. And in the foreword of that report, it is written in a Dunoon context, the word community is widely cast, as you will see, draw out an exemplary environment for young people to learn, grow, find future opportunities and contribute their own ideas. And teachers are encouraged to think for themselves and take an outward-looking approach to their job. External partners in the public, third and private sectors have become part of the Dunoon Grammar family. And that sums up what Dunoon Grammar does and how it could be a wider model for other schools across Scotland. Now, that's not to say that the school is perfect, and it would be wrong not to acknowledge that, like many other towns in rural Scotland, there are deep-seated challenges within that community. Vulnerable pupils still need support. The mental health of young people still needs addressing. Yes.
Stephen Kerr.
The point he's making about the transformative power of a school, the pivotal thing, the thing that makes this all possible, would he agree, is leadership. And that's what we have. Dunoon Grammar. We have leadership. We have a leader and we have a leadership team. And if every school in Scotland had that empowered sense of leadership and autonomy even, does he believe that we could transform every school in Scotland into a Dunoon Grammar?
Donald Cameron.
Thank you. I'm firmly of that view, and the member says eloquently what I personally believe. I'm not saying that Dunoon Grammar is unique. There are plenty of other Scottish schools that have a similar level of engagement with their communities or allow their teaching staff to think creatively and outside the box. And other schools do remarkable things. I'm sure members will draw that to the attention. But it's very fortunate, and Stephen Kerr mentioned leadership, that David Mitchell, is the head teacher there. And, it's no wonder he was shortlisted for Head Teacher of the Year in 2023.
I can give Mr. Cameron a wee bit of extra time because he's been generous with interventions. Finlay Carson.
I thank the member for giving way. My apologies for missing the start of this debate, but I just wanted to put on record that the head teacher, David Mitchell, cut his teeth in Dumfries and Galloway. So Dunoon's gain is certainly Dumfries and Galloway's loss, and the culture around the school there is something that is admired everywhere. I think Dumfries and Galloway could certainly take some lessons from what's happening in Dunoon.
Donald Cameron.
Thank you. I didn't know that, and I thank Finlay Carson for that information. But given much of the decision-making around education is obviously the responsibility of local authorities, it is down to the leadership of those authorities to make or break innovation in education. And it's important to recognise that of all the many achievements of Dunoon Grammar that occur, they have occurred under existing structures and systems. But if there were greater freedom and greater empowerment of head teachers, then even more things could happen. Now, I must draw my remarks to a close, but can I lay a direct challenge to the Cabinet Secretary, who I'm delighted to see is here? What will the Scottish Government do to learn the lessons of the Dunoon Grammar success and ensure that in any way it can, that success can be replicated across Scotland? Because it is a brilliant example of what can be achieved when teachers are given the freedom and support to think and act creatively. It's a brilliant example of what can be achieved when pupils are made to feel part of something bigger and are encouraged to think about social good. I should mention there are currently Dunoon Grammar pupils in Tanzania currently undertaking work there. It's a brilliant example of what can be achieved when the local community has a stake in the success of their school. And Dunoon Grammar, David Mitchell, his team, his leadership, his teachers, his pupils, past and present, have achieved so much and will no doubt go on to achieve much more. But to help Dunoon Grammar and every other school in Scotland, it's imperative that we in the Parliament remove the barriers to success and let our schools flourish. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Cameron. We now move to the open part of the debate. I call Emma Harper to be followed by Liam Kerr. Ms Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to take the opportunity to congratulate Dunoon Grammar School as well, and I also congratulate Donald Cameron for securing this debate, and I'm happy to support his motion. Presiding Officer, I want to add my thanks to all at Dunoon Grammar School for their hard work, dedication and commitment to the community, but also for providing the school-age learning experience which spans a lifetime for the pupils. The many achievements of the school, which have been well rehearsed by Donald Cameron, are testament to the school's ethos of continually improving and doing all they can to ensure the best outcomes for young people. Dunoon Grammar School has a very long and distinguished history, spanning over 350 years of growth, of which high standards of academic and personal development have been the hallmarks. A huge well done goes to all the school community. Presiding Officer, when preparing for this debate, I had a wee discussion with my head of office, who attended Ayr Grammar School, and we had a blether about the history of grammar schools in Scotland. Scotland has many schools, like Ayr Grammar and Dunbar Grammar in my South Scotland region, which are called grammar schools, but are now essentially the same as other state schools. And although historically these grammar schools would have acted independently and were, and in some cases still are, viewed as providing high quality academic education, it is important to note that these schools are not the same as grammar schools in England and Northern Ireland. With that in mind, I want to share some of the exceptional work of schools in the South Scotland region, which are working to provide the best possible educational outcomes. One such school is Lockerbie Academy in Dumfries and Galloway, under the leadership of Brian Asher. Lockerbie Academy is very much an integral part of the town and embraces fully the town motto, which is Forward, building on their vision around improving the future of the local area for pupils and community. Lockerbie Academy's twin purpose, to be a place where pupils feel cared for and above all to learn, drives their desire to be the best that they can be. The Academy has, every year since the Lockerbie air disaster, has worked with Syracuse University in New York as part of an exchange programme. Two pupils from Lockerbie travelled to Syracuse and vice versa to lay a wreath on behalf of the town in remembrance of all those who died in the air disaster. It's massively appreciated by the town and the wider community and has led to the school being nationally recognised by Education Scotland for their leadership with this scheme. Another fantastic example, Presiding Officer, is Dumfries High School and Kyle Academy in Ayr, both of which have been leading the way with the Vision Schools Scotland programme. And the programme aims to encourage and empower Scottish schools to enshrine Holocaust education into the curriculum to ensure that every young person learns of the horrors of the Holocaust. And just last week, I had the opportunity to meet with S6 Dumfries High School pupils Brogan Matthews and Katie Donald, and their teachers, Lizzie Smithard, who is the history teacher, and Philip Cubbin, who's the head teacher, and I met them at Dynamic Earth for a Vision Schools Awards ceremony. Brogan and Katie have been leading the way with Holocaust education in the school and had the opportunity to visit Auschwitz earlier this year. This is vitally important work, and I thank the pupils and school communities of Dumfries High and Kyle Academy for their work. Finally, I want to give mention to Stranraer Academy, which was recently awarded the Young Enterprise Team Programme Award. Stranraer Academy is where my first secondary school was a long time ago now, Presiding Officer. But what they have done there is they have a programme they've run over the full academic year. It involves students from S5 and S6 starting their own student company over the course of the academic year. And this company, what they did was, through key milestones, they developed an idea, conducting market research, they created a product or a service, and it's ultimately that was then promoted and then they traded for it. So the award that they've received is well deserved. So, Presiding Officer, in closing, I put my thanks on the record to all our fantastic schools and, of course, Donald Cameron for securing this debate and raising the profile of Dunoon Grammar and raising this motion this evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Harper. I now call on Liam Kerr to be followed by Rosa Grant. Mr Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to Donald Cameron for bringing this debate to the Chamber and giving me an opportunity for a brief contribution. Last May, Chris Deering, the Director of Reform Scotland, made what I think is a very important point when he said in the High Dunoon report that we heard about, there is much focus in the media and elsewhere on what is wrong with Scottish education, but it's also important to talk about the success stories, those projects from which others can learn and benefit. He makes an important point because we all know that, as David Mitchell, the head teacher, put it, the current financial situation makes it even harder to provide a wide range of opportunities for young people, as do the many other issues impacting Scottish education at this time, which we've rehearsed in this chamber many times. Yet Dunoon Grammar School has achieved all that it has, quote, without additional resources or any special measures. So says Gillian Hunt, the educational consultant who authored this report. And that's why it's so crucial that this Parliament not only celebrates Dunoon Grammar's success today, that we've heard so much about and will do, not only that we commend the pupils, staff and partners who've made it all happen, some of the examples of which Donald Cameron gave earlier, but also ensure that we find out what is working and explore and evaluate what makes this model of success. Now, crucial to that seems to be this idea of an education system or a facility which doesn't exist in isolation, that doesn't exist in a silo, but rather works and exists as part of an ecosystem. And what we've seen is a school in Dunoon Grammar School which already operates in that way, one which exemplifies the idea of taking a village to raise a child. As the High Dunoon report put it, the school sits at the heart of this environment and its purpose is clear: to provide everything and anything that students need to thrive and be successful. And a huge part of this is making sure that this environment and wider community can thrive and be successful too. I will.
Fergus Hewitt.
Yes, I warmly endorse Mr Kerr's sentiment that we should be more positive about the achievements in schools throughout the whole country. And I claim no moral superiority in casting stones than anyone else here, so let me say that. But does Mr Kerr not agree that the nature of negativity, which far too often characterises the debate about education in this chamber, does none of us any good? And perhaps does the institution as a whole considerable gratuitous harm?
Liam Kerr.
I think it's a very interesting point, and I'm grateful for the intervention. I think that, as I alluded to earlier, there are significant challenges facing the Scottish education system. In this sort of debate, I don't think it would be right for me to go into what some of those are and what I believe that some of those are. But it is the responsibility of this Parliament to address those challenges by setting them out clearly and trying to work cross-party to find those solutions. But I absolutely agree that where success, such as we're seeing from Dunoon Grammar School, is apparent, it absolutely deserves to be celebrated, but also aired in exactly the same way, in order that the lessons of Dunoon Grammar School can be learned. Because some of those successes we actually heard about earlier. And one of the results, of course, is that the school won T4 Education World's Best School Prize for Community Collaboration in 2022. Presiding Officer, there are only 5 categories, and they are open worldwide. To put this in context, the year they won it, the runners-up were from India and Brazil. It is truly incredible. Now, we've heard some of the key factors, and we will no doubt hear further the key factors this afternoon which have led to this success. And they might be summarised as truly collaborative partnerships in the community, an outward-looking approach and a focus on how sectors can learn from each other and apply that learning. But I have to say, one thing is clear, whether from the report, from what we'll hear in this debate, from the various commentaries that I've looked at when researching my remarks today, at the heart of all this is the head teacher, David Mitchell, who's joined us in the gallery today, who has driven this and is even described, rightly it seems, as a local hero. Although, of course, many have contributed. For example, Jenny Minto raised two others earlier in her intervention. So, Presiding Officer, I want to close with the words of Gillian Hunt, writing for Reform Scotland last year in her paper, Making Effective Collaboration in Scotland a Reality, because I think it embodies what we are discussing today. She said, I challenge the new First Minister and the Education Secretary to refocus attention on education and to ensuring that all of our children and young people succeed. I urge them, she says, to recognise the need to create a new system, an ecosystem, and to actively promote and support the contribution of third sector organisations to this ecosystem. That seems to me inarguable, and I look forward very much to hearing the Cabinet Secretary's response to that challenge later this evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Kerr. I now call Rhoda Grant to be followed by Ariane Burgess. Ms Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I want to add my congratulations to Donald Cameron for securing the time for this debate, but also to congratulate Dunoon Grammar School, their head teacher, staff and pupils on their huge achievement, winning the award Best School in the World for Community Collaboration. And I think I also want to recognise the role of Argyll and Bute Council in supporting them. And they've done a number of projects that they've taken part in, streaming bingo and other games to local care homes during COVID, which must have been a lifeline for the people in the care homes, as well as really strengthening the intergenerational bonds in that community. So they've also launched an app helping their neighbour reduce food waste. And probably the most important thing of all, they have a student advisory board for the Dunoon project. Now, the Dunoon project's looking at an awful lot of things that will help put Dunoon on the map and make it a centre for excellence for outdoor activities and other things as well. So being on the advisory board allows them to work closely with the project. And it's not only helping Dunoon right here and right now, but it's also helping Dunoon in the future and actually providing a future for those very pupils, because it'll provide them with job opportunities in years to come, as well as the skills that they're learning every day as part of that. And learning in different ways benefits all young people, because they learn in a way that suits them best. And we all learn differently. We all take on information in a very different way. But seeing different ways of learning actually motivates everybody and means that everyone can be part. So if you're not very good at book learning, you certainly may be very practical. All those skills come into play when you have a rich diversity of the way you learn. And I quote the head teacher saying, allowing students to take part in activities that are actually real learning experiences, and not, they may not feel like that, they may not seem like that, but they are, and they add to people's knowledge. So I really congratulate them on that. And everyone does win from this, and an issue that I have taken on board for a long period of time is rural depopulation. So we know that young people are pushed out of their communities because of depopulation. Indeed, in Argyll and Bute, we saw 2.4% population fall. Now, it's so important that those young people are part of that future, that they're building the future for themselves, and that they're creating opportunities that will allow them to stay at home. I mean, last week we saw the Herald ran a major week-long series on the population crisis in the Highlands and Islands. A bit north from Dunoon in Fort William, they based themselves in Fort William, but actually saw for themselves what is required to retain young people in our communities. And first and foremost, of course, it's a home. But also it is about feeling part of your community and also having the same opportunities in that community as you would if you moved elsewhere. And that's why the work of the school is so important, because not only are those young people being furnished with the imagination to create opportunities for themselves, they're actually being part of that as they learn. So I think other schools could learn from what Dunoon Grammar are doing. And yes, I'll give way.
I'm most grateful to Rhoda Grant for giving way. And concerning our remarks about population and depopulation in the Highlands and education, and in particular the excellent series of articles by the Herald about the current problems facing particularly more remote Highland communities and islands, is the serious risk of massive further depopulation of 10-15%, not perhaps the most serious threat to education, because of the risk that schools will simply close because of the dwindling school roles, and therefore repopulation with development in the Highlands encouraged and enabled by this government is absolutely essential.
Rhoda Grant.
I absolutely agree, because we don't want to halt depopulation by keeping our young people in their communities if that is somehow a lesser opportunity for those young people. What we have to do is create the opportunities and the future within the communities so they're not forced out. And I hope the young people in Dunoon will have choices about where they make their futures, and making their future in Dunoon will be an excellent opportunity for them.
Thank you, Ms Grant. And I now call Ariane Burgess, who will be the last speaker before I ask the Cabinet Secretary to respond. Ms Burgess.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I'd like to also thank my colleague in the Highlands Islands region, Donald Cameron, for lodging this motion and providing an opportunity to discuss the excellent work carried out at Dunoon Grammar School and the potential it demonstrates for community-supported education across Scotland. I had the pleasure of visiting Dunoon Grammar in the lead-up to COP26, when I met with students who were part of the Eco-Sustainability Group to discuss the action needed on climate and nature. And it was a tremendous conversation that I had with them. And also at that time, David Mitchell, the head teacher, gave me a tour of the school and showed me all these other amazing activities that people were up to. And I had the opportunity to talk to other students and also staff at that time. And I certainly got a tremendous impression of what's taking place in the school. I'm looking forward to returning to the school soon to meet again with Mr. Mitchell and to work with pupils on developing a place plan for their community alongside Dunoon Community Development Trust. And it is wonderful to see Mr. Mitchell, pupils and staff in the gallery here this evening. Dunoon Grammar's example doesn't just reflect excellent practice in community engagement. It is transforming what a community is perceived to be and how our young people engage with their local environment, neighbours and culture. That community engagement goes much deeper than the fundraising events and occasional open days that we're all probably familiar with. Working with third sector organisations and social enterprises in partnership to achieve common goals inspires pupils and adds to the vibrancy of life in the town. How many pupils know what a place plan is, let alone will take part in creating one? And yet we all know how vital, safe, connected and flourishing community spaces are to young people, whether that's creating places that make it easy for them to travel on foot or by bicycle, ensuring high quality play and recreation provision, or creating environments that are well lit and feel safe for meeting friends. Making our built environment, especially in rural areas, welcoming spaces for young people is a key but often overlooked aspect of our rural populations. So too is ensuring there are secure, well-paid jobs in a variety of sectors, and crucially, that the young people growing up in rural communities are equipped with the skills that they need to secure them. We know that in the last year, jobs in the renewable industry have increased by 50% in Scotland, and many of those roles are in my Highlands and Islands region. There's also a growing demand for skilled tradespeople and engineers to build the 11,000 rural homes the Scottish Government is committed to creating to retrofit and insulate existing homes and to install and maintain low-carbon heating systems. Increasingly, we are taking a whole range of new job openings up directly by tackling climate and nature emergency through peatland and rainforest restoration, woodland and deer management, and ecotourism. These job opportunities, like the development roles in the Carbon Neutral Island Scheme, give young people the opportunity not just to have fulfilling work within their rural communities, but also to play a part in shaping the future of these places. And maybe, based on this place plan work, we'll get a few students inspired to become much-needed planners. Education is about so much more than producing the workers for the future. It's about developing creative, critical thinkers, nurturing talent, and inspiring the next generation through curiosity and a love of learning.
Would Arianne Burgess give way?
Yes.
Ferguson.
Arianne Burgess talks about the importance of jobs in the Highlands. A great many jobs in the Highlands consist of people working in the oil and gas industry and who live and commute to work offshore and form a staple part of many, many communities. Does the member, like me, value, cherish, support the jobs in this sector, which are going to be necessary for some considerable time to come?
Arianne Burgess.
I appreciate the member for that intervention. What I value and cherish is that we have a future for future generations in Scotland and on this planet. And what I want to see is a just transition for those oil and gas workers to other sectors. Renewable energy is one of them, but there are many other opportunities, and that's what we need to get on with. The approach taken at Dunoon isn't just about financial resources, though investing in closing the poverty-related attainment gap is vital. It's about reassessing that which is truly valuable to a community and ensuring education provision locally meets those needs. Dunoon Grammar is not afraid to take risks. It tackles challenges head-on and empowers pupils and staff to find new solutions and take those risks. As MSPs, how can we work with local authorities to ensure more schools can follow Dunoon Grammar's example? How are we supporting collaboration between schools and community organisations? And crucially, how are we supporting the sharing of knowledge and expertise between schools so that best practice like that at Dunoon Grammar is captured and innovation is celebrated?
Thank you, Ms Burgess. And I now call on Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gorouth to respond to the debate on behalf of the Scottish Government. Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, thank you to Donald Cameron for lodging this motion, and thank you to colleagues from across the Chamber for what has been a really positive debate this evening. As Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills, I really welcome the opportunity to celebrate excellence in education, and undoubtedly there is so much to celebrate at Dunoon Grammar School, as we've heard today, and I have committed to visit the school along with my colleague Jenny Minto as a constituency MSP in the coming weeks. Of course, the school's success, Presiding Officer, is really a testament to the hard work of the staff, the teachers in the school, and those that have been created as well, the opportunities by the senior leadership team working shoulder to shoulder with the local community. And it is also, of course, a testament to the pupils themselves, who, like all of our young people, have been through so much in recent years, but continue to inspire us all. And we have heard contributions from members across the Chamber this evening, Presiding Officer. I'm going to come to those momentarily. Before I do so, I want to put on record a welcome to the pupils who are in the gallery today, and particularly to their head teacher, David Mitchell, who I think there was some debate amongst MSPs about where he belonged to in terms of his constituency and his origins, but that's what MSPs do. But welcome to our Parliament. This is your Parliament, and it's fantastic to see you here this evening. Donald Cameron spoke with great warmth about the reception he received from Modern Studies pupils. And I have to say, as a former Modern Studies teacher, I would expect no less. The world's best school for community collaboration. What an accolade, Presiding Officer. I'm so looking forward to visiting the school in the not-too-distant future to see for myself the excellence on offer. Now to respond to some of the points raised in the debate. Emma Harper spoke about the history of the school. And I think, as we all know, Scotland has a very proud educational legacy, and we will do well, I think, to learn from that and to build on that history. She also spoke about the Vision Schools programme on Holocaust education, and I met, of course, with Kyle Academy at Dynamic Earth only last week. I was delighted to be part of the awards ceremony, which recognised the intrinsic importance of Holocaust education in Scotland's schools. Liam Kerr mentioned talk about the educational ecosystem, which I know has also been inspired in the report, and I hope to meet with Gillian Hunt, who I know is in the gallery today, on my visit to Dunoon in the next few weeks. And I say to Liam Kerr, as he knows, I will always work on a cross-party basis in relation to education, but his office is shortly to receive, if he has not already, an invitation to mine this afternoon, which has been extended to members of the opposition, to talk to them directly about educational reform. And in the coming weeks before, I hope, subject to parliamentary business being agreed, Presiding Officer, we will have a wider debate across the chamber about educational reform, and I look forward to working with members on that. Happy to do so.
Finlay Carson.
I thank the Minister for taking the intervention. Would you agree with me that a good educational facilities like Dunoon Grammar underpin the long-term sustainability of areas, particularly rural areas, and not just for the people who are currently living there, but those who may be attracted to move to the area? More jobs, more businesses, more homes, and good education is absolutely key to that. And if that's the case, will you join me in condemning the proposed fast-track mothballing process for Dalry Secondary School and rural Glen Kens, and encourage a wider community wellbeing consideration for the long-term future of that school, similar to what we see with Dunoon Grammar?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his intervention. Of course, he's raising a very specific local issue. What I would say is the mothballing of any school would be a matter for the local authority. However, as Cabinet Secretary, I do retain some powers in this area, and when that comes to me, I will look at the recommendation, of course, from school inspections to that end. Much of what we've heard today, Presiding Officer, reflects some of the very best of Curriculum for Excellence and also developing the young workforce. And it's been more than a decade now since we launched developing the young workforce, our youth employment strategy. And I'm always struck by the debates on school reform, which often sit in a rather siloed area. Mr Day, of course, is leading on wider work in relation to skills reform. And I think these two agendas could be better joined up. And I look forward to working with the opposition on that point, because I think some of what we've heard today, some of the real strengths in Scottish education, are already doing that work. I do think that Curriculum for Excellence gives a broad framework which gives teachers that empowerment and that freedom momentarily to give learning and to provide teaching experiences that best suit the needs of their individual young people. It is a far less prescriptive system than existed prior to its introduction.
Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful. I'm enjoying listening to the Cabinet Secretary's comments. I just wanted to make sure she's going to address. I thought Rhoda Grant made an interesting point about rural depopulation. And one of the other but related challenges is ensuring that rural areas have sufficient teachers. So can the Cabinet Secretary tell me, what is the government doing to ensure that new teachers particularly choose to make their lives and careers in our more rural areas to ensure the future of these key parts of our country?
Cabinet Secretary.
Question from the member. I would like to give him more of a substantive answer. As he may be aware, I commissioned work on this very point last year from the Strategic Board for Teacher Education, which is to provide me with a report essentially on options to move forward. At the current time, we have a waiver system which allows probationary teachers to tick the box, as I did some years ago, and that incentivises young people, or maybe older people, to go to other parts of the country to learn how to become a teacher. As the member knows, we've seen a fall in relation to the numbers of teachers ticking the box, and I think part of that has been informed by the pandemic, with less people willing to move than might have been prior to the pandemic. But I think we will need to look at this work in further detail. The challenge I face as Cabinet Secretary in this space is, of course, that I'm not an employer of teachers. That is a matter for local authorities. So I need to work with COSLA on this very important matter. But that's actually why Verity House, the new arrangement we have with COSLA, I think will be pivotal to driving some change in this area. The member may be aware that one of his colleagues has been raising questions on this very point in relation to issues in Aberdeenshire, which I look to be visiting in the next couple of weeks, alongside the GTCS, who make decisions about where student teachers are allocated, to really address the member's point in much more detail, because I think we can't have a one-size-fits-all policy for the whole of the country. We need to recognise local differentiation, and different local authorities also can put in place some support. We've seen, for example, some of our island authorities in the past look to provide financial incentives to encourage people to move there. And there are, I think, a range of other opportunities that the Strategic Board for Teacher Education is going to give me further advice on. Happy to do so. I'm conscious of time, Presiding Officer.
I'm most grateful to the Cabinet Secretary, and I shouldn't eschew this opportunity to ask what progress she's making in relation to Dunoon Academy, Aberdeen and every other school in Scotland in promoting the uptake of the indispensable skill of touch typing amongst children in Scotland, as something that would be incredibly cheap but enormously valuable as a massive investment in skilling our children for the needs of the century.
Cabinet Secretary, I shall give
I'm
you extra time.
I'm always impressed by Mr Ewing's ability to get touch typing on the official reports. Pupils in the gallery will understand that Mr Ewing has a keen interest in this subject area, and broadly I would support him. Of course, the Government has invested in digital connectivity. There's more we need to do in that regard, particularly actually in terms of the changes that are proposed in relation to our qualifications, much of which will rely on that digital connectivity. Now, I'm conscious of time, Presiding Officer. We heard from a number of members today about the breadth of qualifications that are now on offer in the senior phase, even compared to 20 years ago. Pam Duncan-Glancy made an interesting contribution, I thought, in an intervention in relation to the SEQF and actually why that framework is so important in giving that parity of esteem across the board, where traditional pathways are actually being replaced by much more flexible routes to recognising achievement. And that's good for our young people. There's not a one-size-fits-all model, as we've heard again today. Rhoda Grant talked about the challenges in relation to depopulation, and I think that's actually why the flexibility that Curriculum for Excellence lends is really important. So Dunoon Grammar School, I know, has facilitated access to over 50 skills-based courses to empower students to work in professions vital to the local economy, to keep them in the local area. And I think that practical, experience-based curriculum also allows our young people to learn about crucial industries like travel and tourism, design and maritime studies too. I know the school works really hard to develop the entrepreneurial skills in its young people additionally, and that young people at the school have a really key role to play, I think, as we've also heard this afternoon, in the Dunoon project, the town's plan to build a massive mountainside tourist attraction, creating jobs for Dunoon's young people. That community collaboration was really a spirit, I think, in part, a theme of today's debate, Presiding Officer. That wider approach to school education, which doesn't always just look at the school building itself. And it's very clear that with the support from their teachers, their support from a strong head teacher, I should say, and strong leadership, but that wider school community has enabled young people to have the best opportunities on offer to them at Dunoon Grammar School, not only in their local communities, but more broadly, I think, and indeed internationally, as we have heard through the motion today. Presiding Officer, from remotely engaging with care home residents, as I think we heard from Rhoda Grant during the pandemic, to presenting climate change solutions at COP26, as I think we heard from Ariane Burgess, the young people of Dunoon Grammar School epitomise what it means to be effective citizens, one of the four capacities which underpins curriculum for excellence. And I'm really proud to have recently looked at some of the fantastic work that's under consideration at Dunoon Grammar School, and to ensure that that work helps to inform our education reform plans as we move forward. To conclude, Presiding Officer, Donald Cameron set me a challenge, which I wholeheartedly accept. We have to learn lessons from the outstanding examples set by schools just like Dunoon Grammar School. So I commit to visit the school in the coming weeks to ensure that our education reform work is informed by excellence in our classrooms, just like that exhibited by Dunoon Grammar School. Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.